In CRC Paul, the place to be. Amen. You know, before I say what I want to say this morning, just I maybe should have done it last week, but I thought I'll do it this morning. I just want to say well done to all you Grey supporters on your teams, whatever we call it. You did well, amen. But let's talk about the Stormers and that comeback yesterday, amen. Way better, amen. But you listen still, kyk julle nie rugby nie. Huh? Any Boys Eye supporters here? Where are the Boys Eye supporters? Julle hande so kalm opgaan. Amen. Amen. We can always come back, amen. We can always come back. Amen. We're continuing today on where we started last week Sunday, and I started a series called The Fellowship of the Kingdom, and we spoke about last week Sunday on all fellowship starts with our fellowship with God, and that's the most important place to start. And then we shared on, we have fellowship with God mainly as Christians in three areas. We have fellowship with God through His Word, by reading the Bible on a regular basis. They used to indoctrinate us as little kids in Sunday school. They used to say, "Lees your Bible in bid elke dag." Who sang that song in school? We sang it often, and it stuck with me now in my 40s. I still sing that song sometimes to Levi. I sing a lot of songs that we used to sing as little kids. I sing to Levi. One of his favorites is, I'm giving my age away here, maar ek is nie 'n stapsoldaatjie nie. Ken jy hom? Can I get to feel a song? Yeah, okay, listen. So, but we have to have fellowship with God, because all other fellowship flows from our fellowship with God. And so we said fellowship in the Word, fellowship in the Holy Spirit. When we receive the Holy Spirit through the evidence of speaking in tongues, the Bible says that's the way that God wants us to engage with Him, is in the Spirit. And then thirdly, we said that we have fellowship with God through His church, His bride. And to live a fulfilling, rewarding Christian life, you have to have fellowship in those three areas. In the Word, in the Spirit, and in the church. Because this is a place that we've prepared for God so that we can meet with Him. You have many ways in meeting with God. You have many places that you can meet with God. But the church is also one of the places where we meet with Him. Amen. And so this morning I want us to delve in a little more into that word I described last week called koinonia, which is a Greek word that refers to fellowship. You are a product of fellowship. You were created for fellowship, and you need to fellowship in order to achieve fulfillment and satisfy one of the highest needs that make you a human. Amen. And so our scripture verse for this series is Acts 2, verse 42, and it says, they were continually and faithfully devoting themselves to the instruction of the apostles and to fellowship, to eating meals together, and to prayers. And so I want you to think for a moment about the Acts experience where 120 believers were gathered in the upper room waiting for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And so the upper room was a place in someone's house that was on the upper floor. Sometimes it was a hidden space because the people were persecuted, so they hid from the Roman soldiers. But it was a confined space in which 120 people were waiting for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And to think about it for a moment, what must have taken place in that room? Here you are in a room full of people in a tight space, and you're 120 people waiting for 10 days for the Holy Spirit to appear. Now you know what you feel like after your family come and visit for a weekend. Amen. You're ready for a break. Or when they come and visit for December. It's not that you don't love them, but the space is confined. And we're in each other's company and we're in each other's way sometimes. But here were these 120 people in a confined space. And it would have its social and personal challenges. Because bathing was not something that they were accustomed to. You and I might, at some days, shower or bathe twice a day. Bathing, in their context, maybe happened on a monthly basis. And so here they were, these 120 people, for 10 days in a confined space, waiting in the upper room for the Holy Spirit. Now, one thing I can guarantee you, because it didn't start out with 120, it was a little bit more, but 120 stayed. After those 10 days, jy weet ietsie omtrent die ou wat langs jou sit. Amen. You know, most likely, what he's had for dinner the previous day. You know the fragrances emanating from him as you sit next to him. You know his thoughts. You know, maybe you share a conversation, and as the days go by, these conversations get deeper and deeper because you forced it to this place. And so after these 10 days, I think we could quite clearly say that these people were a tight-knit group. Having endured 10 days, not knowing when the Holy Spirit is going to appear, because there was no word from God or a word from the angel that said, wait 10 days. They were just there in that space waiting for 10 days. And I'm sure it served a purpose. And I'm sure when they left that place, they knew each other intimately. And so of all the things that the Holy Spirit could have instructed the apostles to do after they received the Holy Spirit, the main thing they did in establishing the church and spreading the gospel is he led them to preach the gospel, to testify about Jesus, and to have fellowship. Those are the two things through which the church was established: through the preaching of the gospel, sharing their testimony, and the sharing of life together in meals, in breaking of bread, and doing life and doing church together. Those were the two main things that caused the church to grow and still exist today, 2,000 years later. Think about that for a moment. They didn't set up a gospel training center, a school of apostles, an organization, or a discipleship academy. They went about telling people in their world about this Jesus. They got together to eat. They got together for church. And they got together for prayer. Basic, simple, fundamental things that they did, which established the gospel and caused it to spread throughout the world. And so we read in Acts 2, verse 44 to 47, it says, all the believers... come on, say all the believers, were in fellowship as one body, and they shared with one another whatever they had. Out of generosity, they even sold their assets to distribute the proceeds to those who were in need among them. Daily they met together in the temple courts and in one another's homes to celebrate communion. They shared meals together with joyful hearts and tender humility. They were continually filled with praises to God, enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord kept adding to their number daily those who were coming to life. We touched on the word koinonia last week, and we said it means close association, it means participation, it means sharing, it means contribution, and it means relationship. And so what you see in Acts 2, verse 44 to 47 is the full expression of koinonia. You see close association. You see sharing. You see participation. You see generosity. You see contribution. You see relationship. So you see that word koinonia in its full expression in Acts 2. And so in our search for deeper meaning and more revelation sometimes, we sometimes miss the simplicity of what the gospel really is and how it is expressed through our lives and daily living. The early church consisted of people from all walks of life, cultures, religions, generations, different standings in society, and from different backgrounds. It was through this melting pot of diversity called the church that this gospel message spread throughout all the earth. Just take a look around you, in the row next to you, behind you, in front of you. Take a look around in this church, and what you see in this building is exactly the same thing that we see in Acts 2. A group of diverse people, a melting pot of people from different backgrounds, different standings in life, different cultures, different generations, coming together in one place under one God. The gospel. Take a moment to look around. There's people different to you. There's people with a lot of hair. There's people with a little hair. But we're different. But what unites us is our common purpose in worshiping God. And so for this gospel message to be relevant in preaching about a loving God who accepts all people no matter who they are or what they look like or where they come from, surely then the people who preach this message would then have to live it by example. In the fellowship of the church, these people were forced to deal with their pride, their prejudice, their racism, and their preconceived opinions of people different to them. And as Christians, sometimes we have blind spots and we tell ourselves, but I'm a Christian, I believe in God, and I love people, and I love all people. But can I tell you that as Christians, we all have blind spots? Areas where we are naturally inclined to be a little bit more prejudiced towards people because of whatever reason. And so God brings Christians into a place where they are forced to deal with those things. In a place where people are different to you, in a place where people sound different, believe different maybe, in a place where people come from different backgrounds. In a place where people are from a different culture or from a different generation, and God forces you in the assembly of the church to deal with the issues of your heart pertaining to people and the world out there. Because how can you love a world out there if you can't love in here? Amen. When you read Acts 2, you see that the people that believed and formed part of this group of believers consisted of Jews and Gentiles from regions of Asia, Egypt, Africa, Europe, and Arabia. Every kind of person you could think of was in Jerusalem at the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Every tribe was represented. It says in Acts 2, verse 5 and 6, it says, at that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. You see, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost was strategic and significant in that God orchestrated this knowing that people from all over the world would be in Jerusalem at that exact time. It's no coincidence that on the day of Pentecost, which actually means the 50th day, that the Holy Spirit was poured out and the believers left the upper room immediately, went into the streets, started praying profusely in the Spirit, and these people recognize, but this is so-and-so, and I know him, and he doesn't speak my language, and suddenly Jews were speaking Greek and African languages by the power of the Holy Spirit. So imagine the impression it made. And then from that point, through those people, the gospel spread throughout the Mediterranean, throughout Africa, throughout the Middle East and Asia, and Arabia. The gospel spread because of a coming together of people from different backgrounds. And so here's my point. There's no coincidence to you being here amongst these people in this town and in this church. There's no coincidence. God orchestrates meetings. God orchestrates purposefully when it comes to His church. And so the very fact that you're sitting here in this building this morning was orchestrated by God for you to hear this message and to recognize the fact that God uses people, and you need to be in fellowship with people for this gospel message to spread. And so the people in this place might come from different backgrounds to you, different cultures, different generations, but God has called us together in this place for a specific purpose. And we need to recognize that, because this gospel does not work in isolation. I'm going to say it again. You cannot be effective as a Christian in isolation. You can't. That's just contrary to what the gospel is. This is not a gospel of isolation. This is a gospel of fellowship, of coming together, of meeting together, of being together. That's why you should be in this place every Sunday. If you are in the area, the rule is come to church. I understand we go away for weekends and we go away on business and we go away for weddings and all those type of things, and I understand that. But for the most part, when you hear, be here. Because God has a meeting and an appointment with you in this church. It might not be perfect. It might not be complete. But I said to you a few Sundays ago, any place that is prepared for God is a place in where God shows up. And so this is a meeting place, a place of fellowship that we have with God. There are many things that make us different, but we're all united in the Spirit because of the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And in God's eyes, that is the most important thing. God doesn't really care about your portfolio, what you have and what you don't have. When God sees you, He sees you through the eyes of Jesus. And He understands that wherever you go, Jesus goes. And wherever Jesus is, there's grace, there's hope, there's salvation, there's love, there's care, there's support. Because Christ in you is the hope of glory. Look what it says in Acts 4, verse 32 and 33. It says, now the company, I like that, of believers was of one heart and soul. And not one of them claimed that anything belonging to him was exclusively his own. Think about that. Not one of them claimed possession for anything that they owned. In their mind, everything they had belonged to the church and belonged to the people in the church. That car that you brought here this morning might be your family car, or might be the car that you get around with to go from point A to point B, or go to work or go home. But that car, in God's eyes, belongs to the kingdom. It should be a car in which you bring people into the fellowship of God. It should be a car with which you pick up people to bring them to church. I'm trying to show you the mindset of a Christian, because we've lost that mindset in the world today. We've picked up customs and ways and habits of the world, and we've isolated ourselves as Christians, and we tell ourselves we're okay, and you might be heaven bound, but you'd be completely living outside of purpose. If you don't understand the mind of a Christian, and I'm trying to reveal it to you through these scriptures. And so they said, but everything was common property and for the use of all. And with great ability and power, the apostles were continuously testifying to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace, meaning God's remarkable loving kindness and favor and goodwill, rested richly upon them all. you know what was the result of their fellowship? Their sharing, their participation, their contribution, their caring relationships, their sharing of their testimonies. You know what the result of that was? Because many of us are looking for those things to come upon our lives, and we look for it in many different ways, and we do many different kinds of religious activities in the hope that that would come upon our life. But we see there in Acts 4 what was the cause that attracted the grace and favor and blessing of God into their lives. Because it says there, I'll read it again, in verse 33, and with great ability and power, the apostles were continuously testifying to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace, God's remarkable loving kindness and favor and goodwill rested richly upon them all. If you want to attract the grace and the favor and the goodness and the goodwill of God in your life, then my advice to you is to live the way that these people lived. Because it's there for all to see, in plain English, that the cause of their close association and the cause of their sharing and the cause of their contribution and the cause of their relationship led to the grace of God and the favor of God and the mercy of God being upon their lives. Amen. And I've never seen this portion of Scripture quite like this before. And this revelation excites me, because I know what this could mean for our church if we get this right and if we start living like this as a company of believers. But I know as well what it would mean for your life and your family and your career and your business and your future if you chose to live like this. That I have everything in common with the people in this room. That nothing I have is my own. And I will participate. And I will contribute. And I will share. And I will build. And I will fellowship. And I will have relationship. And what you'll see is a grace upon your life like you've never seen before. Because God is not a man that he should lie. Throughout the ministry of Jesus, you will see him connect, interact, and influence people in different ways and at different times for different purposes. And many of those meetings took place in someone's home, around a table, or with a meal. And so in closing, I want us to look at two meals that Jesus had at different times for different reasons. And it's important that you see what I share in this, because a lot of times I preach a message or I share like I'm sharing on this, but people don't get it. They just don't. You hear it, but it doesn't connect. It doesn't register. But if you understand that all of you are here and saved today as a result of this working, amen? Someone prayed for you at a home cell. Someone invited you to a meal. Someone reached out to you. Someone built relationship with you. Someone connected with you. Someone had fellowship with you and drew you into a company of believers. I cast my mind back to the time when we started this church 6 years ago. We started as a little home cell of about 15 people in Peter and Leonie's home. They're sitting there in the middle. 15 people with a vision to build a church. Started in someone's home like Acts. And then from there, it grew to about 20 people. And so we said, listen, this is not the upper room. Although Peter might have felt that he can handle 120 people in there, we had to multiply. And so we planted a home cell in Hoopy and Lissy's home sitting at the back there. And so from there, we planted a home cell in Wellington, and so the home cells grew and multiplied because of a simple thing called fellowship. Coming together around a common cause for a purpose. And the church grew. That's why it's so important that you understand that what the enemy is trying to do is exactly what Jesus told his disciples he was praying against. Because he said to them, the enemy is trying to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. The word sift means to separate and isolate. We understand the process of sifting. And so what the enemy has tried to do in the world today is he's tried to separate and isolate Christians from the church, from one another, and from fellowship. And so we tell ourselves that we're okay and we're saved, but we don't see the enemy eating away at our faith, pulling us away from the people and the places that God has called us to. Amen. And so when we come together to pray like this on a Monday, I realize, and that's why sometimes I call the intercessors to intercede at the altar, because I do understand that you might be going about life thinking you're okay, but when you look again, the enemy has sifted you and you're separated and isolated. Things happen, and they happen very quickly in this life, and you have to understand that you haven't been called as an individual, you've been called as a church. Together, we impact this region. And the reason I say that things happen very quickly, listen to this story. On my way to church, Iselle's in Cape Town on a workshop this whole weekend. And so she phoned me this morning, and they were on the side of the N1, and she was driving with another lady, and someone ran across the road, and they hit the person, and drove over the person, and killed the person. He's dead. But I realized this morning on my way here, that situation could have turned out completely different. The accident could have been way worse. And we lull ourselves into a false sense of security. But life happens very quickly. Very suddenly, things you didn't plan for. And so when you're invited to a home cell, and when we have a place like this where we can meet together on a Sunday and get together on a Wednesday, my encouragement to you would be that that would be some of the priorities in your life, that you say to yourself, I need to be there. Because I don't know who I'm going to pray for, who I'm going to meet with, who might need me to help them and encourage them. We get very busy with the affairs of life and forget that God has called us for a purpose. And so the first meal Jesus had, Mark 2 verse 15 to 17, it said, later Jesus and his disciples went to have a meal with Levi. Among the guests in Levi's home were many tax collectors and notable sinners sharing a meal with Jesus, for there were many kinds of people who followed him. But when the religious scholars and the Pharisees found out that Jesus was keeping company and dining with sinners and tax collectors, they were indignant. And so they approached Jesus, disciples, and said to him, why is that someone like Jesus defiles himself by eating with sinners? And so they were doing their own people in. They were robbing from their own people for the cause of the Roman Empire. And so the Jews despised the Jewish tax collectors. To them, they were just as bad as the Romans. They were evil people robbing the Jews. But here Jesus calls Levi, this tax collector. He receives purpose, follows Jesus. And that very same day, Jesus goes and has a meal in Levi's home. And so the Bible tells us that in the home and around that table, the people having a meal were other tax collectors. And the Bible refers to them as notable sinners. Now, if you're a notable sinner, then your sins have become quite well known. Amen. They're not speaking here of getting drunk and smoking weed. These were people actively sinning. Notable sinners. We could call them sinners of note. Amen. Like I was. And so Jesus' dinner or his meal with these tax collectors and sinners draws the attention of the religious leaders, and they take issue with Jesus sharing a meal with these people. And so Jesus addresses their religion and their hypocrisy and makes his purpose for having this meal very clear. I have not come for the healthy. I have come for the sick. We can't isolate ourselves from the world as Christians. We have to engage with all kinds of people for the purpose of seeing them saved. And you'll notice that the disciples were there with Jesus. And so Jesus was obviously discipling them, teaching them. But also there were witnesses to the meeting and what Jesus was saying. There were people around Jesus who was in agreement with what he was saying and could add to what he was saying. And there was accountability in their group. And so your life should not just consist of sharing and having meals with Christians. That is a place for us to have fellowship as well. We need to do that. But here Jesus shows us an example of having a meal with tax collectors and notable sinners, the very worst of society, and there he was amongst them. And so you as a Christian, you can't isolate yourself from the world. And so the next time you have a dinner or a braai or a social event, you have to think strategically like Jesus did and see, how can I reach these people? And so your strategy has to be, I'm going to invite some sinners, but I'm also going to invite some Christians. And then you see this thing play out and this multifaceted relationship start to build and grow, and you see a melting pot in your own home similar to the church as Christians and sinners interact. And the reason you do that is so that you stay accountable as well. Because I can tell you, when I first got saved, I went back to my friends with a purpose, purely of getting them saved, and I was saved a few weeks. And guess what happened that Saturday evening? They got me drunk. Saved a few weeks, they're gonna change the world, but there I was, man alone. Kijk, hierdie ouens was rof en grof. Okay, they were chief sinners. We got up to some stuff when I was in the world. And so they like, I saw they were eating away at me. And when I looked again, there I was, pulled down to their level. And so don't go and have fellowship with the world in isolation, because sometimes they might pull you down to your level and you'll compromise. And when we see again, you're on Facebook doing a petty hooner. Jullie lach, want jullie weet. And you got your shirt off. Is daai nie my home cell, Larry? And so when you engage the world and reach out to the world, be accountable and bring Christians into your world as well. Because that's just wisdom. And so when you're trying to reach a couple or reach a family or reach people for the purpose of the kingdom, don't just irritate them and tell them about how great your church is and send them a scripture. Do those things, but you'll be more successful in fellowship. Because they'll see, okay, these are normal people. They have braais. They enjoy a glass of wine. Don't be shocked. If you go study what was at the meals and at the Last Supper, there was wine at the Last Supper. Jesus handed the wine to the disciples. But he didn't lose himself. And the disciples didn't lose themselves. But sometimes the world needs to see that you're a normal person who loves Jesus, loves his church, and who loves fellow believers. And that will be an attraction to other people who are lost and have no purpose. So don't feel like you have to go it alone. If you've got friends in the church, then say, we're going to invite some people. Maar asseblief, moenie laat ons jou die leeu loop sien doen nie. Want jy bou die koninkryk. John 13, verse 2 to 17, and this is a meal we all know. It says, it was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. And then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. And when Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, you don't understand now what I'm doing, but someday you will. No, Peter protested, you will never wash my feet. And Jesus replied, unless I wash you, you won't belong to me. And Simon Peter exclaimed, then wash my hands and head as well. Lord, not just my feet. And Jesus replied, a person who has bathed all over does not need to wash except for their feet to be entirely clean. And you disciples are clean, but not all of you. For Jesus knew who would betray him. That is what he meant when he said, not all of you are clean. After washing their feet, he put on his robe again and sat down and asked, do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. I tell you the truth, slaves are no greater than their master, nor is the messenger more important than one who sends the message. Now that you know these things, God will bless you for doing them. Now, there is so much in this passage of Scripture, I can just do a whole series on that alone. But there's two things I want to take away from it. Jesus went to this dinner, arranged this dinner, knowing full well that in that room, and the people whose feet he would be washing and feeding with food and sharing a meal with would betray him and would deny him. And he still goes to the dinner. And he still shares the meal, and he takes it up a level, and he serves them by washing their feet. And so people in church are going to betray you. People in church are going to deny you. And people in church are going to hurt you. But here's some news for you, a news flash. That's what broken people do. And as soon as you point a finger at anyone in the church saying so-and-so is this and that, he's a hypocrite, he's that, you are pointing to yourself because you are part of the church. And so immediately you elevate yourself to a position that's reserved for God. Because only God can judge a person's heart. And so be very careful in a company of believers like this church to cast judgment upon people, to point fingers at people. I want to say this to you because I know that some of you have been hurt in churches. You might have been hurt by Christians or even hurt by pastors or religious leaders. And I'm sorry that that happened to you. But the church is a hospital that consists of broken people. It would be like going to the emergency room with your issue and being offended with all the sick people around you. Amen. Imagine that. Ga naar die dokter toe. Nou is jy kwaad vir die mense rondom jou wat siek is, maar jy's ook siek. And so broken people hurt people. In the years of being in ministry, people have said things about me and have discussed me and still do. And I've been through some stuff and it hurts, and I've thought that I want to give up on ministry because it's not nice when you hear these things. And here's the sad part for the people that do it is at some point in time, what you've done and what you say gets to the other person. Whatever is done in darkness, God will bring to the light. So don't get into a place where you're discussing Christians and discussing the church of God and discussing the pastor, but you yourself are broken. We are broken people. I, as I'm standing here, am broken. I have faults and mistakes and issues. My wife can give you a list of stuff. Maar jy's net so gebroken. Maar God sê, wees lief vir die mense in die kerk. In die gebouw. But here's the lesson. Jesus continued in his purpose. He shared a meal with his betrayers and his deniers, and he still served them. You're going to have to endure some things in your relationships in church. But it's not a reason to give up on your faith, and it's not a reason to give up on the church of Jesus Christ. People are going to hurt you. They're going to disappoint you. They're going to miss the mark. But let God be judge. You be the Christian. You love them. You serve them. You pray for them. The Bible says, bless those who curse you. Turn the other cheek. The second thing that Jesus did is he taught them how to serve one another by taking the lowest position in washing their feet. The context of this situation, and I know it's a powerful thing when we do it in church and the pastor maybe calls up a few people to wash their feet, but it actually serves no practical purpose by doing it like that. Although you can do it prophetically, maybe. But the washing of feet in the time of Jesus was left to the lowest servant in the house. The slave with the lowest rank washed the feet of the guests who came in. And so Jesus immediately took up the lowest position. And the reason why they washed their feet is because the tables that they were sitting at weren't the type of tables that you and I sit at on a chair and we're fairly high. You were literally 30 centimeters away from the other person's foot. So here's the table, there's the foot, and there's your food. And so these people wore leather sandals, walked on dusty roads, and most of them had sheep and goats and cows. And so you can imagine what was going on with their feet. Amen. Didn't make for good company. And so the reason why they washed the feet before dinner was a practical reason. Because dinner would not be nice with a bunch of smelly, dirty feet. And so Jesus takes up the lowest position and washes their feet and teaches them something. Because the task of feet washing was left for the lowest person in the household. Jesus became the least of all in service to his disciples. And so immediately when you walk into a church, you come to a home cell. Don't elevate yourself, but take the same position of Jesus and understand that in this place you're here to serve. You're here to serve your fellow man, your fellow Christian. You're here to serve the purpose of God. And have a mindset when you look at people in the world and when you look at Christians around you and ask yourself, how can I best serve these people? Because Jesus said, in the world, it's like that. We flash our achievements, then we share our titles and everything we've amassed. But Jesus said, amongst us, it will not be like that. If you want to be the greatest, become the least. And so in this church, it must not be like that. Because the moment you walk in the door, the ground is level. And you have to have a mindset to serve. And so what I want to see in our church is that every Sunday when we close off in prayer and everybody is free to leave, that you maybe just pause a moment and go to someone who's different to you. Or go and greet someone. Or go and ask, can I pray for you? Or go and encourage someone. But what this lockdown has caused is the message ends and people leave and belt for the door and go and do their thing. And maybe you have stuff to do, I understand. Life's busy. But you have one day in the week to get away from all the busyness and for a moment focus on someone else and the purpose of God. And so when's the last time you spoke to someone of a different age than you, of a different race than you, from a different background to you in this church? When's the last time you went to the coffee shop and bought two coffees and just took it to someone? When's the last time you had in your home someone from a different race or a different culture at your table and have a meal with them? Have you ever had someone of a different race in your home? Have you ever had someone of a different culture at your table? Because that's what Jesus did. And so the authenticity of Christianity and this church and the authenticity of your Christianity and your faith rests upon these very basic things. That you can share a meal with people different to you. That you can serve someone maybe lower than you in society. But that you understand that every time you have a meal, have fellowship, come together, get into church, that ultimately you're there to serve God's purpose. And if Jesus came to serve the least of these, then how dare we stand up and say, that's not me. And these things aren't going to happen if we don't speak about it. And I've never preached about it, and I've never heard it preached by someone else. And so God's put this on my heart to talk to us about a church that it's not going to change unless we talk about it, unless I step on your foot and maybe offend you and confront you with the truth of the gospel message. That's in its most basic form was about worshiping God, testifying about Jesus, and having fellowship with the church and with the world. And if you're not going to get those things right, then you're never going to be fulfilled as a Christian. It's impossible. I see it all the more as I study these scriptures and as God reveals these things to me, that there are certain things that God gave us to live by. Not just to speak of, but to be authentic in our faith and to recognize the world around us and the people around you in this building. And to understand that you're here to serve the purpose of God. Whatever your stature in society. Amen. And so my final instruction to you is practical. Consider before you run out of this place this morning to maybe go to someone, to maybe encourage someone, to say, you know what, can I take you for breakfast? Don't you want to come have a braai at my place this afternoon? It's like, yes, the day, Pastor, there's no need my plan any. I'm pursuing the helmet, your plan. Consider for a moment that we have this very brief time on earth to make a difference. And that every moment we have an opportunity to reach out to people, we should do it. Because you might not get that opportunity again. I had a lot of plans for the weekend before my father died. And in a moment, he was gone. And so you have no promise of tomorrow. No promise of tomorrow. Bible says, live while it's called day. Make that phone call while it's called day. Make right when it's called, while it's called day. Invite someone while it's called day. Reach out to someone while you still can. Because you have no promise. Nothing's guaranteed in this life. Live it to its fullest. But remember to reach out to your world. And so my final instruction is, church, let's love one another. Let's serve one another. Let's help one another. Because that's the gospel message. John 13:35 says, by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Speaking of the church. And so if we don't get it right inside here, we're going to get it wrong out there. And so let go of your offenses. Maybe someone hurt you and offended you. Give it to God. Let it go. Restore that relationship. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Don't hold on to things and unforgiveness. Amen. Do you agree with me this morning? Amen. Come on, let's stand our feet as we close off. Come on, every head bowed, every eye closed. No one looking around. Just you and God this morning. Right there where you stand. I preached a very basic message, but salvation isn't complicated. And so the reason why God sent Jesus Christ, His one and only Son, was to reestablish fellowship with His people. But because of sin, that relationship, that fellowship with God was broken. And God restored that fellowship through His Son, Jesus Christ. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. And so it doesn't matter where you stand this morning. It doesn't matter what you've done in life. It doesn't matter how big you sin. It doesn't matter how far you've backslidden. The Bible says God loves you as you are. And He sent His Son to die for you so you could be forgiven of your sin, so you could receive an abundant life, and so that you could have a place in heaven. But this is not something you receive by default. It's like any other relationship. You have to pursue it. And so Jesus this morning makes this offer. He extends His hand and He says, listen, I am extending grace to you. I am extending love to you. I am extending restoration to you. I am extending hope to you. I am extending the restoration to the fellowship with the Father to you this morning. Will you accept it? You're not born again and restored again with God by association. You are restored, set free, and saved by choice. God sends no person to hell. People choose hell because they reject Jesus. And so you have to choose this morning. The Bible says God places before you life and death, blessing and cursing. And God says, choose life. And the way to that life is Jesus. He says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. You have no life until you have Jesus. I came to that revelation 16 years ago. That what I thought was life was a fake, was a copy, was a fraud. But the moment I received Jesus, I received that abundant life that He speaks of. And so maybe you're listening on the radio this morning and Maybe you're watching online on YouTube or on Facebook and you hear me speaking these words and speaking to your heart this morning, and you realize that you've never received or accepted this life, and you realize that you need to do this. If that's you, in a moment I'm going to pray with you. Maybe you're standing here this morning and you realize that I am that person that has been sifted as wheat, that I have been separated and isolated from God, from His church, from His people. And maybe you've lost your way a bit and you realize that God's calling you back to this place of fellowship and intimacy with Him. Then this prayer is for you as well. It's for anyone that says, God, I want to come to You. It's for anyone that says, Lord, I need You. It's for anyone that says, Jesus, You're my Savior. And so if that's you this morning, you're saying, Pastor, please pray with me this morning. As dit jy is volgend, jy sê, ek het Jesus nodig. Dan wil ek met jou bid volgend. As dit jy is en jy sê, ek voel ver van God volgend. Wil ek vir jou sê, hy is hier. Hy wag vir jou. Net soos die verlore seun sê, kom net terug na my toe. Maybe you lost in the world. Maybe you were serving God one time. But God's calling you back this morning. The Bible says the prodigal son came to his senses. And so maybe this message has helped you come to your senses. Then this prayer is for you as well. So while believers and leaders are praying in this place, if that's you and you're saying, Pastor, please pray with me. I need Jesus. I need to come back. If that's you this morning, right there where you stand, just lift up your hand high so I can see it. So that's me. Pastor, please pray for me. I need your prayer. Thank you. I see your hand. Lift your hand high above your shoulder so I can see. It's dark in this place. Thank you. I see your hand. Thank you. I see your hand. Come on, one more time. If that's you this morning, it's nothing to be ashamed of. It's the Holy Spirit calling you. It's God speaking to your heart right now. If your heart's beating in your chest, that's God connecting with your spirit. It's Him calling you. One last time, that's you. You say, Pastor, please pray with me. I want Jesus. I want to come back. I want to be restored. I want a brand new life. Then one more time, if that's you, just lift up your hand high and say, that's me. Amen. If you lifted your hand, you can drop it. Look up at me this morning. There's a few of you that have lifted your hands. And I say praise God for that. Because it's the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, that reveals Jesus through these scriptures that was preached this morning. So your response has not been to me. Your response has not been to a man. Your response has been to Jesus, who has spoken to you through the Holy Spirit this morning. And so I say to people every time they've lifted their hand, that seat that have been keeping you comfortable this whole time, throughout the service, right now represents the seat that either keeps you in your comfort zone or keeps you away from God. Because you showed by the raising of your hand that you understand that you need to make right with God. And so that was the first step of belief. But right now you have to take another step of faith. And so if you raised your hand this morning, you're saying, Pastor, I want you to pray with me. I want you at this moment, take your Bible, your cell phone, your personal belongings, whatever you brought with you this morning, leave your seat, come to the aisle closest to you, come and meet me in the front here, and we're going to pray and agree with you. Come on, church, let's encourage those and clap for those that have raised their hand. Come on, leave your seat. Come on, take a walk. Take a step this morning. Come on. Come on, church, encourage them. Clap for them. Come on. Come on, keep clapping. If you want to come, you can come. If you want to come, you can come this morning. Not too late. If you want to come, step. Step. Come. Come. Not too late. If you want to come, come. Jesus is for everybody. 10 more seconds. If you want to come, come. We'll wait for you. Come. Amen. Amen. Come on, you guys in the front, put your hand on your heart, and we're going to pray a simple prayer. Come on, church, you do the same. Reach, stretch out your one hand to them, and we're going to pray together with them this morning. So repeat after me. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I thank You that You died, that You rose again to give me life And this morning, Jesus, I receive that life. I thank you that all my sins are forgiven. I thank you that I'm washed in your blood. I thank you that I'm whiter than snow. And I thank you that from today, I'm a brand new creation. I'm a child of God. I belong to you, and you belong to me. Lord Jesus, I ask you that you help me to walk in fellowship with you, to walk in fellowship with your church. Here is my life, Jesus. Use me for your glory, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Come on, church, let's clap and celebrate with those who made this choice this morning. Come on. Amen. Amen. You guys in the front, we're going to pray with you after the service. So please, altar workers, take note. And after the service, connect with them, pray with them. You can take your seat, and we're going to continue with the service this morning. Amen. Come on, church. Let's encourage those this morning who have made a decision. Come on. Heaven's rejoicing this morning.